This is tape number 9, an interview with Mrs. Hanna Lifschutz. Hanna, who's in this picture?
On the right-hand side is my mother, and the picture is when she was very young, probably in her 20s. And she died when she was 28. And this is my father, on the left-hand side, who was her husband. And his name was Joseph Rubin. And he was probably here, he looks older, but he must have been in his early 40s. He looks ancient here, doesn't he? But there must have been a...
Okay.
And the nose, like my father. Yeah, this was my mother. Look, she was lovely, wasn't she?
Mm. Yes. How old was she when she had you?
She must have been 27. This picture represents my maternal grandparents, my mother's parents. That on the right-hand side is my grandmother. Her name was... You know that I forgot her name? I know my grandfather's name was Abraham, but I don't remember...
And the last name?
Kahane.
And they were also from Poland?
Yes, they were from Poland. And they were born in Poland, and they lived in Poland all their lives. I mean, my grandfather died, he must have been 64. And my grandmother was killed in the Holocaust. Yes. Okay. And on the right-hand side...
Okay.
So shall I say it again?
Wait, you signal me. Okay, who's in this picture?
They are my two grandparents. My mother's father is on the left-hand side, Abraham Kahane. And on the right-hand side, my father's father, his name is Lazar Rubin. Different ages, of course. He was an... See how good-looking man he... Grandpa Kahane. Both of them are very handsome, I must say. Are they not?
Okay, Hanna, who's in this picture?
On the right-hand side is my stepbrother Rudolf. Rudolf Lerner was his name. Rudolf Lerner. What a good-looking boy he was.
And you told his story.
I told you how he got ill in the war, and then he died, and how I buried him. Unfortunately,
yeah.
Probably at the age of 22.
And this one?
This one is my younger brother, half-brother, Michael. We called him Michaš.
Rubin,
yeah. Michaš Rubin, yeah.
And he was...
He must have perished when he was about 17.
From the ghetto?
In the ghetto,
Warsaw.
Yes, Warsaw ghetto. North
he was
ghetto.
Taken?
I have no idea what happened. I have no idea. Probably in one of the selections. That's what it was.
And who's in this picture?
This is my stepmother, Rosa. She's the mother of the two boys, Rudolf with her, of her first marriage, and Michaš with a father. My father was, he was his father.
And you stayed with her?
Yes.
Long time in the ghetto?
I was altogether from the age of 6 till the end of the liquidation of the ghetto.
Mm.
I have an album must show you.
Okay, in this picture?
This is I, at the age of 9, I think, and I kept visiting my grandparents, where I spent my first years from practically 1 year to 6 in Makuf, on a visit, on a holiday visit. Mm-hmm. Look at my face. Who do I look like?
And this was, of course, before the war. Of course.
Of course. Age of 9.
Yeah. Who is in this picture?
This picture was given to me as a special present from my cousin Selina Sokolov in her elder age. On the right hand side, sitting, is Nahum Sokolov, who you know was took part in the Balfour Declaration. And on the right hand side is his son Florian. And standing is Selina Sokolov. And when we came from India, we renewed our friendship because I didn't know them in Poland at all. And we became very, very great friends till the death. And
who's Selina?
Selina was the daughter of
Florian
Sokolov. She gave me this photograph to be remembered,
mm-hmm.
and I have very fond memories of quite a remarkable family.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is correction for the former explanation, and if you can tell us now, who's in this picture and what's the relation to you?
On the right-hand side, sitting, is Nahum Sokolov. He was my father's uncle. His wife and my grandmother were sisters. Now, Nahum Sokolov, two children are with him. On the left-hand side is Florian, and standing above them is Selina. And this picture was given to me at some time in the early 70s in London. This is my sister in the middle, Paula Levine. This photograph was taken in still good days, just before the war. And these two postcards, I put them here. She gave it to me at some time ago. I put it in particular because they state the address in Kobe, Japan, where she. Because of this wonderful rescue of the Chune Sugihara, and also it has the German Nazi stamp. That's why I preserve the letters. And in this particular postcard, we thank her all for the parcel of food she sent us from Japan.
This is a picture
of Irena Kersniewska.
Who was?
She was the one with her husband on the right hand side, Roman, who was this very kind and noble Christian people, who accepted me in the time on the Christian side when I was in desperate need of shelter.
Mm-hmm. And this is?
And this is Roman, her husband.
Yeah.
And they were in early 30s at that time.
Yeah. And he was hiding you also?
He was helping me all the time. First the 8 months and then a few months more when I came in overnight to the garage to sleep overnight. And this is the son, Andrew, who is now 54 years old. And he was 4 years old when I left them. And I met them now, the whole family. I will show you the picture, maybe it can be the whole family in with Vivian and Peter. We met them, yes. And he has two daughters, married, and two daughters. Yes.
Still lives in the same place?
No, not in Jelonka, in Warsaw. And they all call me auntie. And when they write the letters, when the father wrote letters to me, and they continue, in every letter is a dry, beautiful flower. I have a collection of it.
Hanna, what's this document?
This is a document which I got now in Poland. They never sent to me. It's a copy, it's a photocopy of a diploma which they which honors the righteous Gentiles for helping Jewish people during the war. The story of my survival and their help was recorded in Yad Vashem. I think it must have been the first time in 58. And then in 78, I met a very charming gentleman in Yad Vashem, and I secured for them a small pension which Hayas, which joined Israel, Hayas, I think, from America, sent them. I suppose they still receive it, apart from my constant and uninterrupted help from 1946, since my arrival in India, till present day. And they are, of course, very noble people.
Okay, who is in this picture?
These are my friends I mentioned during our talk. On the right-hand side is my friend who went to the same school and 1 year higher, or she was slightly older. And this is her first child. This is after we all were saved from Bobrovniki. She went with her husband on the top, Stefan, to displaced persons camp to Germany, and then to America. And I spent with them quite a long time, as I told you, in Poland, in Warsaw, in Bobrovniki. And this is Stefan. Mm-hmm. And he was the one who conducted the whole setup. There was a boyfriend to all his cousins, and allowed me to join them, and I thought he is actually, they live in Arizona, they have one child died, they have a son, doctor of chemistry, and Stefan is now 92 years old, and we telephoned the other day, and this is her sister Janina.
They joined you later on in Bobrovniki.
Yeah. In Germany.
Okay, what's this picture?
This is the photograph I got from a friend of my husband, actually. And this is with his group of friends in Lithuania, in Kovno, I believe, in 1940. And here on this very extreme left is my husband, Simon Lifschutz, my future husband, Simon Lifschutz.
What year was taken?
1940, I think.
40s?
Yes.
Okay.
1940.
Okay, Hanna, what's in this picture?
This is a picture which was also given to me by my sister. It was presumably 1941, when she was with a group, her group of friends, and who were refugees in Lithuania, just before going through the Trans-Siberian train to Vladivostok, and then going to Japan.
She's right in the middle.
And she's right in the middle here.
Hanna who's in the picture here?
This is the photograph I have probably taken with me when I this I look like when I left Poland in May 1946 on my way to India.
Mm-hmm. Well, what age you were? You were 20.
Age I were. This is difficult because when I arrived in India, my sister wanted to take 2 years of my life away, straight away. And she was not sure 2 or 3, but we stopped her. I must have been 20, you know, 90. I must have been 24, mm-hmm. something like that.
Okay.
Okay, who's in these pictures?
This is how, a few months after my arrival in Bombay, on the right-hand side is my sister from a few previous years. Not many, I think it was in 43. And my picture on the left-hand side is from 1946.
Okay. And the wedding here is?
Yes, that was my wedding photograph in front of the Ritz Hotel in Bombay, India, 10th of October, 1947. And as you notice, I have got here not a little bouquet, but a whole broom. Enormous. I don't know who provided it, but it's enough. But may I add that I made the dress myself, and the headgear myself, everything myself.
The 10th, the 16th.
No, actually 16th, you are right. 16th, 10, 1947. Mm. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, what's in, who's in this picture?
You see, in this picture is my husband, Simon, with a retinue of his chief, some of his chief officers, of workers, engineers, and glass technologists, and myself and the children, and his secretary, Mrs. Martha Wartenberg, of the left hand side, on the left hand side, when on one of his arrival from England, probably, where he purchased a machinery for the glass factory.
And this was taken where?
It was taken in Bombay.
Bombay.
And this is Alexei. Mm-hmm. Darling Alexei was very small, and that is Vivian.
Yes. This picture?
Yes, this is myself. Vivian is on the on one side, and Alexei is on the other. And this is the real Alexei. I'd like to appear with you for a few minutes. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes, that's myself in the old good time, and Vivian had to go to orthodontist, as you can see.
Yeah.
And this is
Alexei. And
Alexei.
This was in India.
In India, Bombay.
Yeah. Hanna, what's this document?
This is a very, very touching and a very special, unique document. You see, my husband, when he first started his career in Poland as a glass expert, an expert in building glass factories, his fortunes of war, of course, took him to India. First Burma, then India, then Hyderabad state, which belonged to the famous Maharaja of Hyderabad, Nizam, very famous in his time. Afterwards, during the partition, Hyderabad belonged to India. Now, he had that this first work, what he was actually the second job. He was employed by him, by the relative of the Maharaja of Hyderabad. and he built a vast factory. Now he had the unskilled, about 1,000 unskilled workers. Now, the workers, when they finished the job in Hyderabad, most of them came over with their families to Bombay to join him. Every time he built another factory, they joined him. And he loved them, he was kind to them, he was good to them. Sometimes he was very angry with them if they didn't listen. But they were very grateful to him because he taught them a proper skill to earn the living, took care of the children. It was really quite remarkable, my husband. And this, in 90, we emigrated. I came back with the children in 58 and 59, and in 62, my husband finished building the last factory, and he came to London. And I don't know what is the date, 73. The last factory was sold to the Maharaja or Maharani of Indore. And the workers and the glass technologies and the engineers and the retinue of all the different skilled technical mechanics and people who could, simple people who just helped with the enormous glass, it was also about 1,000 people, they, in gratitude, they sent, I would like to read it. I can't see it, but could I read it somehow? Yeah, and they send this, it is written, workers in India whose lives you have changed and trained us as a skilled workers and made us useful to ourselves, to our families, and to our families. In gratitude and reverence, we are sending you our kindly to you and our kindly Memsap means me, your daughter, your son-in-law, Vivian's husband, and your Chota Sap. He was the little one. Chota means little. Our prayers and healthy New Year greetings, and they signed. And some of them who couldn't sign put the fingerprint, and there were many, but the engineer said 52 is enough. So 52 have signed, and 50, some of them put fingertips, and fingerprints. As you will read it, some of the helpers, some of the fire, at the furnace for maintaining the temperature at furnace, and foremen and all kinds of people who came, and there is a beautiful story attached to this, which I don't know if you want me to tell you.
Tell me.
Yes. Yeah. There were two workers whose father lost in the country. They lived in the country. They lost two bullocks. Two oxen, male and female. And they died. And the father said, "Could your sap help us?" So the two son, and if you help us, my son will forever be in your not only gratitude, but be like in your. Will be in your life and do whatever you want them to do. And so my husband, of course, helped them to buy two new oxen, because you must have two. And the father was happy. And then when the factory was sold, one day we received a letter through the old man to his sons, would my husband release the pledge? Mm. Could they work for somebody else? Because the pledge was given, then all my husband's life they have to do what he wants to. So of course we released it. Very touching story.
Okay, Hanna, can you tell me about this picture?
Yes, you see on the left hand side is the president of Israel, Ben Zvi.
Second
president after Weizmann is Ben Zvi. In the middle is my husband, and on the right-hand side is the president aide-de-camp, Yossi Carmel, with whom we are friendly all our lives. And at the earliest stage of our lives in India, Yossi Carmel was the first one to come from India with his young wife to enlist funds for Israel. And it was very difficult for him, not knowing the community, and they were so different, so many different communities. So we helped Yossi Carmel with the whole fundraising mission. And this took place a few times in India, and then we continued all the time when we came to Israel. It was for United Israel Appeal, it was for Hebrew University, it was for Tel Aviv University, it was every possible art, every possible interview. And we were delighted to do it. And Yossi Carmel, who got very friendly with us, and was this aide-de-camp to the president, insisted that we should meet, that the president will receive us. We didn't want, because my husband was humble man, and he said, because we give money, we do help and give money because we need Israel. We can't live without Israel. This is our country, and this is our future. But it is naturally an enormous honor. And after persuasion, we came over. I was also there, but this is the picture which very kindly we were given the audience by President Ben Zvi.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell me about this picture?
Yes. We were already living, of course. My husband left India when we were living in London and Wimbledon. And when we were in India, we were introduced by the first Israeli consul, Mr. and Mrs. Doron, to Mr. Igal Alon.
Who is on
the horse.
On the horse.
And he, from the straight away from meeting him, he very much liked my husband. He took an immediate liking to him, and they became quite friendly. And on a visit to Israel, I think it must have been later, 67, 66, I don't quite remember, 67 or 70 even, I don't. My husband went to Israel and went to Ginosar, to the kibbutz. And then that picture was taken.
Do you know about Mr. Alon?
Mr. Alon was at one time a foreign minister of Israel. And he was one, I think, who proposed the plan of granting the Palestinians some autonomy. Yes. Oh, this is a photo of later President Katsir. I don't remember which year was it, but do you know President Katsir? But it
the
was
fourth president of Israel.
Fourth president of Israel. It was again because Yossi Carmel, who originally was this aide-de-camp to the President Ben Zvi, left his job with the death of the president, and he became extremely active and became one of the governors later, but was extremely active for years and years with the Tel Aviv University. And because of our work for Israel, some donations, we were given a laboratory in the Tel Aviv University. The laboratory, I don't remember what sort of laboratory it was connected with, but it was called Hanna and Simon Lifschutz. And then he insisted again that we meet President Katsir. And on this occasion we met him. Must have been 62, yeah. on the top, on the, yes. It is the Kierzniewski's home. The Kierzniewski's, Roman Kierzniewski, my really, truly treasured and very much loved Roman Kierzniewski, is no more alive. He was about 80 when he died. And this is his widow, Irena, who was a beautiful girl. You made a photograph before of her.
In the middle.
In the middle. I embrace her off my, and this is her daughter-in-law on the left-hand side. I embrace her. This is on my visit to Poland in May 1995.
50 years later.
50 years later. And we are marvelous friends. This is one. And the bottom one. And this picture is again in the home, of course, on the same morning or afternoon. And I'm standing next to Irena. And Vivian is next to her. And Peter, because they went with me to Poland. And they came and we visited all the memorials. And on my left-hand side is my Irena's granddaughter. One of her granddaughters, she has two. And down here is her daughter-in-law. And it is in their home. Yes? On the left-hand side is the picture of Roman and Irena and Andrew Kierzniewski. This is how I knew Andrew. And he was 4 years old. Irena was lovely, beautiful, and Roman. This is, I think, a picture taken a little earlier, maybe just at the beginning of the war, or just immediately before the war. But they looked almost like when I had met them. Okay. Yes.
Yeah.
This is a picture of Irena. And Andrew, who is 54 years old, and Irena is, I think, 82. And he has got an allotment near Warsaw. And he took me to this allotment. It is in front of us, and it is near the forest. And they grow the, you know, vegetables and flowers. He spends a lot of time there. This is taken on the same day, on this allotment, which is showing part of it, where Andrew grows flowers and vegetables, and I'm embracing my dear friend Irena. This is only one, the only piece left.
Of what?
Of the wall, which wall encircled the ghetto, the small ghetto.
The small ghetto?
The small, where I was, yes.
And who's in the picture?
I and my daughter, mm-hmm. Vivian and I. And that was sort of, I don't know, blessed or something by the president of Israel, but by Chaim Herzog.
And this was taken when?
In 1995.
When you went to visit?
Yes. This is the map of the ghetto, you see? Mm-hmm.
Okay, what's in this picture?
This is the memorial, which is erected after the war by the Polish, I don't know, Polish people, or probably Polish people, because not very hardly any Jews there left. And this is this Umschlagplatz. This is the memorial where, in front of this Umschlagplatz, they have the Umschlagplatz, which used to be, you can see this now, it's built up, was behind, and in front where was the railway station, the railway was, which took people directly to Treblinka. This is exactly there. And it is written there. That 300,000 people perished there in Treblinka, mm-hmm. only. Treblinka, yes. 300,000.
That's it.
Yeah, and there are some of the names of the people taken at random who perished there in Treblinka. Different name. I looked at this, but you see it's written 300,000 people.
Mm-hmm.
300,000 people were taken from this Umschlagplatz, from the Warsaw ghetto, from both ghettos, you see. Because from the small ghetto they took to the big ghetto, to Treblinka, directly to Treblinka. It is absolutely hard to believe when I recollect it, that it has happened, such a thing. Such a catastrophe, such an unbelievable event, which I think has forever and ever changed the face of the world. It did. It has taught people how you can dehumanize the people you don't want to be or you don't like them, like in Uganda or like in, what is the name now, the
Luanda.
Place? Luanda, or like in previous Yugoslavia. You showed what you can do. Hitler showed the world what you can do to another human being, and I think the world will never, never be the same. Unfortunately. It is Rina, it is on the way. This was guiding us. We were told when we went with Vivian and Peter to Poland, and Peter was insistent that we should go and try to find the cemetery where I buried my brother Rudolf. And slowly and slowly, gradually, we found out from people that there existed a small Jewish cemetery, and it is written Jewish cemetery in Anielin. And Anielin.
What's Anielin?
A name of the locality of the village there in Anielin, Nil Otwock. And we were guided. We were traveling for miles and miles by this taxi, and suddenly we have seen this, and you see with the Jewish David Star. So we followed this, and as we followed it, I remember the lane, how I walked under the after the coffin of my brother, with this only one, and with the carpenter, the horse, the cart, the carpenter, and I. And I remember it was a small sunny lane, and on the left hand side was the cemetery, and we found it after nearly an hour, and that was the cemetery on the second picture.
And here is,
you know, part of the, it is now a small, I immediately recognized it. And it is an enclosure, and on other pictures I have, there are, you know, graves, plates of graves, which are some of them very neglected, and some of them are still standing, but most of them are neglecting. It's a secluded place in a no man's land somewhere, with all this lot of sunshine, as you can see, the same was always this bright sunshine and lot of greenery. And people stopped being buried there in 1940, because in 1940 Hitler started sending people to extermination camp. Since 1940, this cemetery doesn't anymore exist, but his bones are somewhere there. And Dr. Peter Lawrence, my son-in-law, was, you see, he wears this little hat, capelet, and he says Kaddish.
For your
for my boy, which is Kaddish is the prayer for the death, the Jewish prayer for the death, yes, for my brother.
After 50 years. This picture?
These are happier times. Thank God, and touch wood till 120. This is my lovely, very devoted daughter Vivian, and her husband, Dr. Peter Lawrence.
When was this taken?
That was taken on a, I think, a very special occasion of some time. Oh, I must have been maybe 4 or 5 years ago.
Yes.
Okay. And who's in this picture, Hanna?
This picture was taken on the occasion of my youngest grandson, Simon, my lovely grandson Simon, it was his bar mitzvah. He's on the left hand side, and in the middle is Jessica, who is a student at Nottingham University, and the first one is Matthew Michael. His second name is after my beloved little brother Michael. Matthew Michael, Matthew Michael, and he has just told you, he finished his university at Sheffield and tries and hopes he can do his PhD at Oxford. The lovely three of them. And the little one was relieved because he was, or was it before? He was going to say the portion at the synagogue and he was very nervous. Mm-hmm. Wait for Inna.
Okay, Hanna, would you like to present your son?
Yes, with greatest pleasure. This is Alex Lifschutz, my lovely beloved son, who even when he was a little boy, a little baby, he was always wonderful, always sweet and kind. And he was excellent at school always, one after another, St. Paul's and the university and one degree and second degree. And he's an architect who has got an established firm in London and is quite successful, thank God for that. And one of the latest achievements is this very famous restaurant in Oxo Building, and the whole of Oxo Building. And of course, building some bridges and changing the whole traffic outside Waterloo Bridge. So as I said before, not only, I would say predominantly, I would say not grateful, but not proud, but very grateful for his consistent help, for making for me this lovely home, for taking care, for taking away and dealing with troublesome problems, and producing this marrying lovely girl, Monique, who they are suited ideally together, and we have a fantastic relationship, and they're producing these two fantastic grandchildren. Mm-hmm. What can I ask more?
And you heard probably your mother's life story.
Sure. As you can tell from the last speech, she's a very accomplished liar. but I'm delighted that she had the opportunity to speak tonight and that she has a tape that tells her very remarkable story, which is an instruction and an example to all of us. And that's the most important thing.
It is for you to keep it, for you to remember it, and you will remember it, but even the future generation, yes, we hope that that Israel can be in peace and be in peace, the main thing. That's what we all need. We need peace, we need shalom. And on this occasion I want to thank very much Rina, who has been a charming interviewer, and James for his patience and excellence in hopefully producing a wonderful tape.
And I thank you. We thank you very, very much. And I wish you again all the best.
Thank you.
Till 120 and shalom.
Thank you. Thank you and shalom. Thank you. Shalom. Toda rabba.